Toasty toast. Toasty toast. 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 Alright, let's heat that up. I think we're toasty. We can get rid of the marquee now, too. Just want to throw it out there real quick while I was dawdling. Welcome, one and all. We're going to be continuing on with our Lucid stream here on Hump Day, halfway through the week. Jumping off of our nonstop climax action down into the depths of the universe. And here we see Lumi waiting for us, surrounded by God knows what. But no, for real, this is going to be a great experience, especially for those of you who are into synesthesia or, you know, concepts surrounding the universe or higher existence or the balance of the world, life as we know it, things like that. You know how we do. Tetsuya Mizuguchi, shoutouts to him, shoutouts to Q Entertainment. Shoutouts to Ubisoft, too, even though there's a lot of things they do that I disagree with. They at least threw money at this game and got it out there in the end. So shoutouts to Ubisoft as well for making this game happen. This game is normally designed to be played with the Kinect, if you're not familiar. I unfortunately don't have access to my 360 Kinect right now, and I don't feel like going to set it up. So I'm just going to be playing with the controller, but that's fine with us. Although, if you do ever get a chance to play this game, I would highly, highly recommend you play with Kinect. It is really an engaging experience, it's a lot of fun, and there's really nothing else like it out there, so if you get a chance, definitely try it. So this game, as I mentioned during our preface, is a lot like Rez in many ways. It still acts as a rail shooter, it still invokes the same themes and ideas, but this time with a more rich world and more rich lore that Mizuguchi has created through his other media work, such as Genki Rockets. So it's a more fulfilling way of presenting his initial concept behind Rez. It's more experience. It's really his masterpiece when it all comes down to it. It's his swan song. And I hope you guys really enjoy it. This is from his mind, and there is a lot that went behind this game, both from him and the community, in fact, which you'll see by the end. But another similarity you'll see now is that we have six distinct levels. Each one behind it rests a track from Genki Rockets, in fact, mixed in a brand new way, specifically for this game. Some tracks debuted within this game. Some of them already existed if you followed the band or artist prior to. So let's go ahead and dive in. We're going to play the game here. At one point, I was really into this game, and I even had some number one ranking scores on the leaderboards. I'm almost scared to see where they're at right now, because they're probably sunk super duper far down below. But at one time, I was a master of this game, you guys. I was getting the top scores. Let me see where my scores have resonated at. I think there was one in particular that I had a really, really good score in. I can't remember if it was normal or hard or connect or not, but I had a damn good score. 140 here. Yeah, that's not too good. Let me see. Oh, there's no rank showing up here. I don't know. Let's try again. No, that one's not working. I don't know, but I promise you, I have a picture of it, in fact. I could find that picture. It's on my MacBook. I have a rank 1 leaderboard score, or I had a rank 1. Here, this one's at 115. Not bad. That one aged a little bit better than Beauty, it looks like. Evolution, was it, maybe? No, no way. It was not Evolution. What about Matrix? No, oh, five, oh, give me a break. Well, you gotta believe me. You gotta believe me. Many years ago, when this first came out, I had some number one score. Okay, moving on from that. Actually, yeah, let's adjust the difficulty. I don't want to be on hard mode. Feel Eden. Yeah, this is your equivalent to travel mode. Free from harm and fear. I kind of want to... No, let's just do normal. Because I still want to get scores and whatnot. I want there to still be some kind of threat for me to want to protect myself from, despite the fact that this is going to be about relaxation and lucidity. Yeah, I'm so washed up, you guys, but I swear I have pictorial evidence of my number one scores. I will dig it out and present it if you so desire. If none of you guys believe me, and you feel it necessary, just be like, yo, 019, dog, homie. Throw me that proof, homie, dog. And I'll be like, aight, yo, and I'll throw it at ya. I will plug in my MacBook, and I will find it. The thing still works, at least. So let's start. We're gonna play Matrix. Matrix is, of course, the first level. Here you see, of course, 100% 5-star rank. Golden 5 stars, in fact. Doesn't get any better than that. We're not going to be obtaining that rank this time, but I hope you guys still enjoy. Child of Eden. Lucid Stream. There you see Lumi. Now, of course, the visuals here really have stepped up their game now that we're on Xbox 360. The sound is still used in similar fashion to the Rez title that you just witnessed. Instead of an avatar, we just have our floating reticle in this case, because it's supposed to be us as the avatar. We are the avatar here, on our Kinect, waving our hands and interacting with everything around us. Those are our power-ups, just like the blue power-ups before in Rez. You see the equivalent here? That's our overdrive move equivalent, those little purple spheres, I believe. Oh yeah, that's right. Okay, so there's another element to this game I forgot to talk about that I completely forgot was in it. Your main objective in this game is actually to release and launch your bullets in tune with the music. You have to do it in timing with the beat, in fact, in this game, and you get extra points for it. I completely forgot about that. So you see here now, I'm going to get perfects all day. Except when I'm fighting off bullets. But I completely forgot about that mechanic. Oh yeah, you gotta use this button. Okay. They also give you a rapid fire attack. This is primarily used for fending off bullets. It's just a rapid fire. You would normally just kind of hold up your hand. And it would spray those bullets in front of you, just like a machine gun. They come in real handy here. I forgot about all these added elements, damn. It's been a really long time since I played this game too, you guys, so bear with me here. We're just jumping right in. This is a fresh experience for you and I. For you and me both. I'm sorry. So you see where the score attack and the leaderboards come from is just your ability to maintain the rhythm, consistently get as many perfects as you can, maximize your target amount, and therein lies the competitive nature to Child of Eden, which I certainly... Oh, I got hit! What? Oh, I forgot. Okay. Which I certainly got into back when this game first came out. Oh, shoot! I'm completely ignoring these. Sorry, guys. Let's go. We're almost done with this boss, actually. We still have life. The blue gauge on the bottom right is our life, so I'm still looking good. You'll notice, too, actually, one really cool detail to the sounds and synesthetic effect of this game is that as the enemies get closer to you, similar to like a horror game almost, there's a consistent sound that creeps towards you louder and louder. It's really cool. Oh boy. Remember these from Rez? Same exact thing. That music picking up. My top priority here is survival. Oh, I got whaled. But here comes our boss. Again, it's a sphere. And what I really like what they do here is the way they creep Lumi's voice into it as you break these enemies free. If you pay attention and listen close, you can start to hear Lumi's voice and her vocals creep through. Oh, wow. Well, that's what I was saying. Pardon me. I was saying earlier, Danby, if the game volume should be louder, let me know. But I asked that question back when I was playing Rez before I played this one. I didn't see any responses to it. Oh, whoops, what am I doing? You see how this game really ups the ante already, though. Already you see here we're above the earth. Four stars, but you get the idea here. This game really implements the same exact synesthetic principles as Rez, but it does so, I feel, on a much higher level. And if you maintain the rhythm and you consistently get those perfect scores and stay on beat with the rhythm, it only enhances the music that much better and adds that extra layer to the overall sound matching with what you're seeing on screen. So it's really ingenious in design in covering all senses. In that way, I believe they definitely succeeded. And that's just the first level here, Child of Eden, here on the Lucid stream. I'm glad you feel that way, Scramble. That's exactly what I want to demonstrate here. This game is truly a mesmerizing experience, especially when you play it on Kinect. But we're going to continue right along now. And move to Evolution, where we again have our 5 gold star rating, but we will not obtain that again. This is a really great level, though, and if you're a fan of Lisa Frank or Fantasia 2000 or what I was talking about before, you'll find extra joy in this level. The overall theme here, again, being evolution. Keep that word in mind as you watch what unfolds here on screen. You see, starting from the smallest kind of life, these molecules, these bacteria in the ocean. Just like the door in Rez. Looked familiar, doesn't it? You can hear Lumi's voice already creeping. These vocals are tidbits from the Heavenly Star song. Or I believe Star Surfer. I'm sorry. I think this is from Star Surfer. This is a Star Surfer track from the first Genki Rockets album. We'll share the vision of you, only one. When the time comes, show you what I see. It's kind of a guilty pleasure, you guys, I'll admit. I pretty much know the words to almost every Genki Rockets song. I got really into it, what can I say? No, this is Starline, not Star Surfer. Starline is the name of the song. Starline. It's been a while, guys. I'm sorry. This is Starline. There's a music video for it on YouTube if you look it up. Starline Genki Rockets. Whoops. Any enemy that's purple like this, you have to do the rapid fire at. I almost forgot about that. Big manta ray. I love these manta rays. I love all the creatures that they put in this level. What's up, Lil Burnout? Good to see ya. Hey, Mega Muffins. Thanks for joining us. Haven't seen your name around here. Welcome to the Lucid stream. I always love the sequence in particular. Don't miss that. The idea here is that you're supposed to use the manta rays to maximize your combos throughout. I'm just doing a poor job of that. But we're not trying to optimize our score here. I'll do my best for you, but I just want you guys to enjoy the game. Oh, wow, ow. Again, this is one that I feel not as many people got to experience. But there's a lot to be seen here. A lot to experience, I should say. Because we're not just seeing. We gotta raise our lucidity. What are we doing? We're definitely not at 22 anymore. We're at about 29. Let's go. 29. There we go. Thank you. course it becomes a beautiful phoenix before your very eyes. Gaze upon the phoenix, now kill it, shoot at it, shoot the phoenix that you have created. Let's try to go all perfects. Ah. Okay, we got it. Okay. Why must you fire at us, Phoenix? We created you. You see here how gorgeous this game truly is, though. We've got the galaxies before us, the stars surrounding us. Oh, I screwed up. Oh, shoot. No perfect. Okay, we got it. There she is. That means we're almost at the end here. Keep it in pace with the music. I'm trying to give you guys just the optimal experience here. Hope you can appreciate it. Show you what I see. Good work, everybody. We did it. We freed the phoenix. We weren't trying to kill it. I was just messing around. I hope you guys understand. We weren't trying to kill it. We were just trying to set it free. Hey, we unlocked another garden reward. How about that? Hey, we're still getting unlockables. Five, six years later, we're still getting unlockables here in Child of Eden. Very cool. Hope you guys are enjoying the game so far. That was level 2 here on Child of Eden. Leisurely play, lucid stream. I think after setting that phoenix free, we can raise our lucidity up to 33. That was a good rhyme. How about that one? I'm a poet and I didn't know it. I can make a rhyme every time here on Child of Eden. Day 17. Let's keep it going with level 3. Beauty. This is one I favor quite a bit, in fact. I really, really like this level. Lots of plant life. You'll see a lot of floral work being done here. But another great track. Very atmospheric level. The way the sound works when you bloom these buds. Everything's just very, very cool. Everything's very thought out. The rocks on the sides kind of forming as our... Oh, go. Oh, look out. Hang on, I gotta get these guys. Gotta get these guys. Oh, I screwed up. Man, I remember when I had this level mastered down to a T. This was my level. This was my level, dog. All right. There we go. Oh, I screwed up. Okay, there we go. So pretty. I love the sound that it makes when you dissipate the purple little orb guys in this little... The drip drop, drip drip drop, drip drip drop, drip 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 drop. If you guys can make that water dropping sound with your cheek when you like kind of pop your tongue into your cheek or your finger or whatever it is, kudos to you. I've always wanted to do that. I've always wished I could do that. It's one of those natural human talents I've never been able to obtain. Chip chip chop chip chip chop. Oh, this game is fun. I love this game. Oh god. No, I gotta use that. I gotta. No. Okay, we got it. Phew. For a level called Beauty, I think it certainly fits the bill. Our lucidity's raising. It's getting higher. It's getting higher. These enemies are cool here. You gotta start by shooting with the rapid fire, and then it reveals their actual targets for you to fire with the regular reticle. Note how the entire environment now is pulsing to the music at this point. Not like it hasn't before, but just a really, really cool effect in bringing full synesthesia to the fold. Chip, 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 chop. Nice. God, I love this level. I love this game. I love this designer. I love everything he stands for. I love the colors, Duke, the colors. I love it all. Perfect. Your drippy drip drop enemy fire won't stand a chance against me. I'm here to pursue life and love. You cannot stop me. No, we didn't get it. We got hit. We got rammed. Game over. But wait, our inner beauty prevails. And we can still transcend. And here we are. This is Res 2, Curly. This is basically Res 2. But honestly, as I've been referring to before, Res was more of the build-up to this game, Child of Eden. This is really the culmination of everything Tetsuya Mizuguchi, the designer here, had been kind of creating in his head from the initial conception of Rez. It invokes all the same principles and ideas and themes, but on a grander scale with a deeper lore, which compiles pretty much everything that he's built up until this point, including things outside of video games. So I don't know how many times I gotta explain it, but it's good stuff. And yes, it is very much so like Rez. Right down to those doors that we've been seeing previously. I've been pointing out as much as I can. Yes, I agree. It is a very intuitive game. And again, remember, this is designed to be played on Kinect. So the idea here is that anybody can just stand in front of a TV screen and start playing this game just by waving their hands around a little bit. And as long as you're in tune with music and you're in tune with your senses, absolutely you can. And it will reward you for doing so in a way you've never really quite experienced before. Gotta get all the pedals. I feel as though, excuse me, I feel it's a real shame that Mizuguchi stepped away from the world of video games, quote-unquote, officially, but I feel as though just because he stepped away in such a fashion from Q Entertainment doesn't mean that he could never not come back and do another game again. I especially say that after, oh geez, the Katamari Damacy designer, who initially created kindergarten sculptures and kindergarten landscapes for children in Japan, also, quote-unquote, retired from video games, only to now come back and make this new game that's coming out on PS4. So I don't think he's out of the game necessarily, and we still have his mind, and that's really all that matters, if you ask me. He can still create art. Which is very much so what this game is, and all others before it. Oh jeez, he got me. And there you have it. The culmination of beauty shown here is just this lovely flower blooming. Moving me, the light shines through me, all the colors spiral down on me. Okay, I'll stop. Enjoy. There she is, our lovely Lumi. The shimmering touch of a gossamer who catches the sunlight. Wow, we only three-starred that one? Well, it's been a while. That was pretty much all brand new to me again. Let's go ahead and raise our lucidity. I feel like I'm ascending. Wow, everybody's bailing out on this game, huh? I guess they're just not hipster enough for it. Nobody can handle the true artsiness and indiness of this game. They can't handle it. All you guys want are your character mascots and your Crash Bandicoots and your Sonic the Hedgehogs and your glossy marketing corporations, man. No, I'm joking. You see, too, how every time you exit a level, this main menu, quote-unquote garden, is always changing dynamically as you enter and exit levels. So now we have a more beauty-oriented aesthetic with the greens and the pinks and the flowers and the enemies, of course, still spawning too. So pretty cool little detail there as well, I'd say. Let's go ahead and move right on, though. We've gone through Matrix, Evolution, and Beauty, and what lies ahead now are Passion and then the Journey. Hope here is a different thing entirely, but we can still play it if you guys want. It's a lot of fun. In fact, I've gotten all the way through to the end once or twice, but it's just a very lengthy kind of challenge mode of sorts. But Journey is the real ending, similarly to how in Res, the fifth level, also in white. In fact, you can note here, there's only one color change compared to Res. The first level is still orange. The second level in Res is purple. Here it's blue. But also in Res, the third level is green, the fourth level is yellow, the fifth level is white. So right down to those nitty-gritty details, you can see all of the similarities here and how this truly was what he wanted to do when Res first came to being, but now he had the technology to make something like this happen and the lore behind it. Passion is a very sexy level. What's interesting about this, though, is that it kind of goes for a more mechanical motif, a more industrial motif. You can even see right now, if you look closely into the yellow sphere surrounding Lumi, you can see gears and cogs kind of floating around her. That's just your first telltale sign of what to expect in this level. So I hope you guys stick around, all baker's dozen of you that are still tuning in. We got some higher numbers earlier. I don't know where everybody went, but at least for now, those of you still sticking around, you're in for a treat. I hope you've been enjoying it thus far. We're going to keep the Lucid stream going and to keep the lucidity rising. In fact, I think this is a little bit low. We're gonna have to bump this up a few notches. Let's bring this to 50%. How about that? How about 55%? There we go, 55%. I think it was too lucid for them. You know, I should talk about this too. There is a danger, in a way, to approaching the world of lucid dreaming and everything like that. There is a danger to it, and this might be what everybody's running away from. If those of you are unfamiliar, there is such a thing as sleep paralysis. Sleep paralysis is something that can occur if you kind of exit the wrong state of consciousness at the wrong time. And what kind of happens is that you're awoken from your sleep, but only in your mind. So you know you're awake, but you can't move your body. Your body is still in an unconscious state of being. So you have no control over yourself, and you kind of go into this panic state or panic mode. And there's a lot of mythology actually behind sleep paralysis before it became even known as sleep paralysis, in the sense that there are things that are commonly referred to that more than one people across countries or across cultures claim to experience during sleep paralysis. One of which, excuse me, I'm sorry, one of which being this being or creature. Some call it an old woman, or you can look it up. I believe one name for it is the old hag. There's other names for it too, and I believe there's actually a movie or two based on this concept. But it's said that during sleep paralysis, you can see this creature or this thing looming over you or looming above you or in the distance or something like that. And it can scare the crap out of you. And it's a really traumatizing experience in some ways. And I can absolutely say it's something that I've even personally experienced. So I can say without a doubt that there is certainly a danger to it. But it's not just trying to execute some kind of lucid dream that can trigger such sleep paralysis. There's other things that can cause that too, certainly. But it's certainly part of the world of it, I would say. And in some respects, you do kind of have to be careful when approaching it, because it's not for everybody, and some mistakes can be costly. So there's a little lesson for you. A little chat for you guys. We're having a little chat scene. A little chat here on the Lucid stream. Just relax, kick back, we're hanging out. I see some of you guys are talking about sleep paralysis. I appreciate all your guys' comments and perspectives. By all means, keep the chat going as much as possible. I may not always be able to respond to it or see it while I'm playing a game, but I always love you guys communicating, by all means. Yeah, scramble. That's absolutely another key example. Even just a thing like having a stressful time or a stressful life can trigger sleep paralysis, I'd say. I mean, it's almost like a night terror in a way, but it affects you physically as well. Night terrors, of course, are spooky enough on their own. You guys are ready for the passion. Turn up the volume. I really love this. This is a track off of Genki Rockets' second album. The title is Maker. This is a track called Maker by Genki Rockets. But you see what I mean already. An industrial motif here. All machinery. I think it is, however, very fitting for this music. I can honestly see the connection. I think it really fits the aesthetic. It's a good choice. And when you're exploring the world and civilization and themes on this high of a level, you have to include this type of thing. Here we go. Look familiar? Level 3 boss, perhaps? I love how the vocals kick in, though, during this moment. Owie. Gotta take down both. I'm sorry, set them free. That's what I mean to say. Set them free. Choo-choo train is my favorite thing. As we move along and we ride and sing. The poo-choo train. No, okay. I'll keep with this song. Oh. Okay, we got it. I got it. Right at the last second. Indiana Jones moment right there. Ooh, I love this section. Check it out. This is really cute. I don't know why I say cute, but I feel like it is cute. It's cute. It's a cute section. The very faint little... I love that so much. It starts getting less cute very quickly. So you see, we kind of ourselves just now constructed the sculpture, and you see it's kind of playing through this history of civilization too in the background. If you can't see that, it's really interesting. The way they incorporate all these different instruments, and particularly when you change between the machine gun and the regular fire, is very, very prominent and cool, I feel. Whenever you go from the orange to the purple, if you're not catching on to that. Gotta keep that beat going. I'm screwing up though. For some reason it's harder to do if I try to do that at the same time. In this way, it almost kind of seems like, at that moment, this machine sprouts wings. If you ask me, I think that's one way to interpret it. Ooh, ooh, ooh. And you can gain all sorts of meanings from a machine with wings, honestly. With natural, angelic wings like that. Oh geez, forgot about this one. Oh, look out! There's an idea for you if you're a hipster artist. You know, sculpt some kind of like engine or a motor with wings. Well, you know what? I guess the Red Wings hockey team already kind of does that, or Red Wing shoes, since it's a tire with wings. That's kind of the same idea. But what does that even mean? If you're a shoe place and you're representing, I guess you're just trying to represent speed? Is that it? I think that's more to represent speed. I think that's a different meaning, okay? So I'm not gonna count that. Let's let my interpretation fly a little bit longer, okay? Alright, you guys. Oh, here we go. I love this. I love the way all of these bosses culminate. The use of music is always vital, absolutely vital, to any piece of media you release, whether it's film or TV, if it can or games, if it can incorporate music in some way, you can use that so much to your advantage in ways that not many people understand or utilize enough. Sometimes things get whitewashed, or things They don't put as much effort or energy into the music as they should, when it could enhance something or change something so much. The music alone can control the tone and atmosphere of whatever it is you're putting out. And with that being said, this game just embraces that concept to a whole new level, just like it did with Rez before it, and what Tetsuya Mizuguchi has done with all of his titles, including Luminous, including Meteos, all these titles that he's put out. He understands this concept more than most, and that's part of what I love about him and the way that he works, and I hope that he puts out more. And there's my little spiel, I guess. I'm sorry, I was getting passionate there for a moment. I can't help it. I'm rambling. And he's got two balls. He's got these two great balls, an orange one and a purple one. Hearts and minds merging as one. This Maker song is really good. There's a lot of remixes of it out there too. Some of them are really stellar. And this one just takes that track and really makes something special, even that much more special out of it. No, I'm not talking about a plane. See, you're messing it up. Oh, I got more garden rewards. A plane has artificial wings. I'm talking about, you know, angelic wings, organic wings. Because you saw there, the texture and feel of those white flaps look more like a cloth or something organic than it did look like a machine or something artificial. because of the way that it flowed and moved and had the curves, whereas everything else in the level was a hexagon or an octagon or a flat-out shape with sharp lines and 90-degree angles. Those white wings that sprouted on that engine that you're fighting were the first thing that moved organically and with a fluid motion like that. So that's why I interpret that as more organic wings rather than just something like a plane, if you catch my drift. I hope that helps. Okay, guys, so we're in for another real treat here. Again, these games aren't long. I never anticipated this to go on too long here at all, fortunately. We're about to go on to technically the final level here, Journey. And similarly to Rez, parallel to Rez, this game, or this level, is what encompasses all the ideas and themes behind these games to the, you know, oomph degree, to the highest degree. And it's really a special experience. Towards the end there's something new, and it harkens back to what I mentioned as far as this game involving the community in several ways as well. So look forward to that, and just remember the higher concepts here at play, and life as we know it, and balance and harmony, and Lumi's perspective as somebody from the outside looking into Earth and what she's trying to obtain. So onward we go to Journey. Hope you guys enjoy here on the Lucid Stream, Day 17, One Leg of Streamathon. Alright guys, here we go. It's time for the journey. I believe this track incorporates a few Genki Rocket songs. This one that we're hearing right now is actually the introductory chords to a particular remix of Heavenly Star, but I believe it progresses from there. Again, remember, everything you're seeing ahead of you was created by Tetsuya Mizuguchi. The music, the band behind the music, the artist behind the music, the visuals, the ideas, the themes, the gameplay. Well, I shouldn't say the gameplay was his idea, really, but this is all his. again, on the same theme as with Platinum Games and Hideki Kamiya and Shinji Mikami and all those greats. Hideo Kojima. Some of the last great Japanese developers. Mizuguchi, of course, officially retired. But I think we could see him again still. And his franchises at least may live on. Getting a little bit more lucid as we go. Eventually, we should hopefully reach 100% lucidity here by the end of our journey. Hope you've enjoyed the lucid stream so far. You're enjoying this journey because it's only just beginning. Chip, 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 chop. So just like Rez before it, we're incorporating elements now from all previous bosses throughout the game that we've experienced. I love the sounds that those little barrier flowers were creating a moment ago there. Every layer is really well thought out and really adds a lot to the musical and visual experience. Damn, I thought I could finish it in time. That's okay. We're still getting more lucid as we go, guys. Oh shoot, I'm too late. I was trying to increase the lucidity. I'm too late. Going back to the competitive nature of this game, any environment where you have these surrounding fish here, you're supposed to use them also to keep your combo going and build up your score. Oh jeez. Okay. That was a close one. I think they're gonna spread their wings and fly away. I think that's what's gonna happen. Ah, and here comes our phoenix. Speaking of spreading our wings and flying away. Oh boy, the running men are back. Come on, step it up! Yeah, there we go. Bring it forward. That's what I'm talking about. I didn't think the game was actually going to listen to me there. Yeah, I guess this whole level is this specific remix. I forgot about that, but it was always my favorite one too, off of the particular Heavenly Star remix album. So when I heard this song start playing when I first played this game, I was quite elated, to say the least. She's trapped inside that little orb. We gotta save Lumi, you guys. We gotta save Lumi. Rumi! We can do it. It's a swarm of locusts. Oh, I'm back. Okay. Smooth transitions. I love the sounds here. Oh. I missed one. Missed a spot. You see the similarity too now between this particular level and the final section of the final level of Rez, when we were piecing together the being known as Eden, that female form at the end of the last level. It was doing these particular poses as it kept gaining pieces and breaking out, breaking free. And you see Lumi here, oops, you see Lumi here is doing the exact same thing. And we're almost back in a similar digital-esque environment here at the heights of the universe. So it all harkens back to the same ideas, both philosophically and aesthetically. The twinkle of the blows of the enemy fire is really special here, I think. Owie, what? Oh. Almost through. Milumi. Whoa. Oh no! Oh no! Really? I was getting hit. Okay. I didn't even realize. Sorry, guys. Right before the climax, too. Oh, I'm really upset about this. Well, you know what we're gonna have to do here? I hope you guys understand what we're gonna have to do. Okay, no, we don't do that. Go to the menu. I feel so silly right now. Let's go ahead and change this. We must just feel Eden. I should have seen this coming. I really should have. I was gonna get bopped in Child of Eden. I know, I'm so sorry, Green Scarf. I ruined this lucidity. We gotta drop this. We got as high as 90%. See, this is what happens when like you're trying to lucid dream and like a dog starts barking or something like that. Or somebody wakes you up. You really need to make sure you plan it out so that you will not be disturbed for a solid 8 to 12 hours. 12 hours, ideally. Before you set aside the time to try to lucid dream. I promise you that. It will not work if you don't set aside the right time for all this. But we have to make sure we get to the game. So we're going to do this one more time, guys. But this time we can't mess up. Go ahead and grab yourself a drink, get yourself a snack. We dropped our lucidity a bit. And that's all my fault. I'm so sorry, you guys. Oh my god, you guys. I feel so bad, you guys. That run got toasted. But this is the run. This can't not be the run. I cannot fail you now. And I will not fail Lumi. One more time. Just like Spike Spiegel, you guys. One more time. Whenever I put out a story, I'm gonna make sure there's a line where character, main character or otherwise, says, one more time, ellipsis. I gotta make sure I have that in there. Oh man, I feel bad for you, Green Wolf, then. That's really rough. I gotta deal with a lot of that too. I don't know how people can live among that kind of thing, in all honesty. We're gonna break the barrier. Tell me, you guys, were you more Kinex or Lego people? Would you say you were Kinex or Lego or Lincoln Logs or what have ya? What type were you? What kind of construction toy did you play with? Both? Okay. My favorite thing that I ever built out of Lego was like this aircraft / duck. And I tried to keep it alive as long as I possibly could before anybody was able to take it apart. It was very sturdy. I ended up using it for a lot of my Pokemon action figure battles and Pokemon action figure adventures that I would imagine in my mind as I played with my Pokemon toys and action figures, that the duck flying came very much so in handy during those moments. I tell you, I was the master at playing with action figures. I don't know about you guys, but if there was a tournament for playing with action figures and making a story out of playing with things, dude, I would have that on lockdown. Like I said, to prove my point to those who are unaware, let me go back to a quick little tale. I guess it's not as much a tale as it is a fact, but hang on, let me kill these things. But throughout most of elementary, middle, and I think even early high school, I couldn't ever stop playing with things and like having things in my hands and using my thumbs and whatnot. So usually even while sitting at my school desk during class, mind you, among others, no matter where I was sitting, it didn't matter to me, I would utilize my pens, and my pens became fictional characters in my imaginative world, and my pens would fight, and boy would they fight. They would fight to the ends of the earth and back. They would fight for love. They would fight for land. They would fight for their beliefs. They would fight for vengeance. I miss those pens. I remember there was one pen that I loved so much that I had to make sure they never died throughout my sagas. It was just too much. It's too much to handle to let go. I was really into water type Pokemon. I guess I still am into water type Pokemon. Those are always kind of my favorite. So I had the distinct advantage of being able to bring most of my Pokemon toys into the bath with me when I was a wee lad. That was always a fun time too. I wouldn't be making Dr. Robotnik, I promise. I would just be playing with my Pokemon toys. I had, you know, a Lapras and a Blastoise and a Poliwrath. I had a bunch of water types, so they needed to be in the water, you guys. You guys, I'm seriously, you guys. They needed to be in the water. Ow! They need to be in the water. Oh yeah, we're in free roam. It doesn't even matter, we can take the hit. Oh, I love this. Why didn't we play this from the beginning? Yeah. Yes, they would fight to spill their blood or their ink. And it was cool because different colored ink mean that they were just a different species of pen, because they would spill different colored blood. No, I always try my best not to make a mess though. I always made a mess on my hands, that was the thing. Speaking of making a mess on hands, and I'm not going to talk about masturbating, I was going to mention to you guys for a lot that I was left-handed. I don't know if you guys know that, but I am left-handed. Let me get rid of these bullets. And the thing that sucks about being left-handed, at least in school, is that any time I would write with a pencil, at least, and this is another reason why I love pens so much, anytime you write with a pencil, all the lead has to rub on the side of your hand because of the way that left-handed people tend to naturally hold it. The side of their hand is resting on the paper, but it's on the left side of the pencil, so it's always dragging behind whatever it is that you're choosing to write. So as a result of that, you're just always rubbing your hand in the lead. So it was always a matter of just finding the right type of ink, using a pen. It didn't have that bad of an effect, and you could get away with it without having a freaking scary birthmark on the side of your hand that people have to ask you, hey, yo, are you turning black? What's going on over there on your hand? And I would just be like, no, man, I just had to write a paper. I was just doing work for school, man. You know how it is. That's my story. I'm sticking to it. Yeah, lead sucks. I agree to Memers. Lead sucks. Let's get rid of all lead. Damn, you cracked me up. That's the beat we're making. Here we go. Oh, I'm screwing up. Come on, get back. Okay, never mind. Oh, there he is. There's another one. Here come the running men. No, he's down. No, I never really had a problem with deciphering left from right in my early days, honestly, because I was left-handed, and I always honestly took pride in my left-handedness, because not a lot of people, I guess, are left-handed. There's a smaller percentage of us. So I took pride in that fact. And as a result, I never was able to not keep track of which direction was left. Left side, strong side, you guys. Left side, strong side. They say that left-handed people die earlier than right-handed people. And they say this, I guess the reasoning is the fact that more of the world is tailored towards right-handedness than it is left-handedness. And that extra strain, I guess, throughout life, and the extra inconvenience and the higher risk of something going wrong because it's not the primary hand, I suppose, is what overall adds to a lowered life expectancy for left-handed people. I don't know if I generally agree with that. I think left-handed people are awesome. I think we could totally outlive your right-handed asses any day, so get wrecked. I don't care what you say. When I need to be, I can be ambidextrous. I'm not exclusively left-handed. I think left-handed people have that advantage. I think it's easier to transition into right hand and be ambidextrous that way than it is vice versa. So. How about them apples? Our lucidity is getting back up there, you guys. I can feel it. I can feel it. Oh, I know what's playing right now. Hang on. Oh, God. Wait, I'm not ready. Oh, I'm getting hit. Hang on, here we go. Okay, 87. Look out! Oh, I love this mode. I can just edit freely. See, in this way too, with this Feel Eden mode, without having to destroy the bullets, we constantly get that change in the sound when you have that creep. There's that gradual rise when the bullets get close to you in pitch. So we get to experience that freely, in fact, with Feel Eden, which is kind of cool in a way. I never really got to experience that before. Oh boy. I think we're getting towards the end here now, guys. Yeah. Our lucidity is getting near max. What would you do if you could lucid dream at will? What will be your first intention? Vengeance on someone? What would your motivation as a person drive you to do first in a world where you could do anything you wanted? Would it be for love? Would it be for luxury? Would it be for travel? I've had my fair share of flying in dreams. Arbiter would see my face. Okay, that's a good dream to have. It will always be a dream. Donate today, and you can see my face though, guys. Ready? Arbiter can't see it, but you know what, guys? Pony up the dollars, and we'll see what we can make happen, aight? No, okay, I'm sorry. Fundraisers happen, and scroll down, and I'm done with my obnoxious interlude. We're getting towards the end here. I'm gonna start calming down for a bit, because we're getting near the end of our journey. We're about to rescue Lumi. Thanks for all your comments and what you guys would do. I appreciate it. That's a good comment too, Danby. For those of you who would like to try to keep better track, I highly recommend you just try to keep a dream journal. A dream journal can be a really fun thing to do. For many reasons, in fact. If you haven't done so already, try to do so now. It's never too late. If you have a dream and any memories still retained from it, write it down. You will lose it eventually. Write it down in as great as detail as you can. Tell the story. I've certainly done that before, and I think it can be very helpful at times, in fact. It's also a useful thing to do if you're looking to try to lucid dream in particular. Keeping track of your dreams and being more mindful of your dreams can help you then be aware of your dreams when the time does come. It's certainly something a lot of people do recommend if your goal is lucidity. Almost through here. There we go. We're coming up on the ending here, guys. I hope you're ready. Shining spiral of gold. Take my hand, find a way out. That's how he stars above. Just believe what's in your heart. No borders between us. Little ways in the back. Wherever you are. It's very gorgeous, though. It's really cool. It goes all over the world here. It's the Pokemon teardrops, you guys. It's the Pokemon teardrops. Drip drop. Everybody loves to do that water drop. Okay, here we go. Here we go. Watch this. Life is blooming. It's not over yet. This is another track from Genki Rockets. You're starting to see it now. Everything that's falling here in front of you are real photographs that people submitted during a particular campaign for Child of Eden. It was some Earth campaign, actually, that was sponsored by Q Entertainment and spearheaded by Mizuguchi. I forget how many there were in total, but I believe the idea was everybody was just supposed to submit their own best photos that represent life, or their own life. And so they just put them all together here in this final sequence, which I thought was pretty neat. There's the doggy, look at the doggy, look at the doggy, okay. Some lesbians here, you see the oh, okay, they're gone now. Oh wait, here they come, see them? Right here, look at the lovely couple, okay. No judgments here. No judgments. But I do love this finale though, with the big Yggdrasil tree sprouting all these photographs and representations of life and humanity on the planet. Yeah, 1,000 dick pics, exactly. That's what they got. These lyrics, of course, are very clearly Japanese and then translated over. So, there's that thing going on. But that's the finale. Yeah, I think there is a Pikachu somewhere in there. I don't think you're wrong about that, in fact. I think there was a Pikachu in there, if I remember correctly. I feel like this would be a great moment for me to like start posting pictures of myself like on my travels and like obnoxiously be like, look at me, you guys, this is what you should be putting your money towards and blah blah blah, and show my face. Like, this would be the time to do it, but I'm not gonna do any of that crap. Sorry, guys. Donate today though. Check out my GoFundMe page. You know my PayPal, 019@gmail.com. I'm just trying to live my life too. I'm trying to escape like Lumi. You can't blame me for that. Our journey continues. Please help me continue, you guys. The end is finally in sight. That's my Kickstarter page, you guys. No, I'm not gonna do it, I'm sorry. The end of the wait is not over. But I hope you guys enjoyed that journey. Again, definitely still encompasses a lot of the same themes, but in this way it just is, it dives a lot deeper and gets a little bit more personal with the people. I love this community effort that they did, and I love everything that this game and Rez before it represents. I love everything that Mizuguchi Rez represents. I love all of Q Entertainment's games. And I hope that you were able to see something special at some point today so far, through either Rez HD or here with Child of Eden. No.